Mark Spies is with Munich University, and he's going to talk about metamodeling and semantic technology interoperability. And Saeed Tabet, am I pronouncing it right?
Yeah, they're right.
is chair of GRC-XML, which I'm anxious to hear about. So.
So thank you very much, Herm. We are welcoming you to our presentation here. And basically, you see, we will cover, as Herm mentioned, two very different things. So first of all, it's about GRC-XML. So this is an XBRL-based upcoming standard for governance, risk, and compliance management. And, Saeed Tabet is a leader of the development group of this standard since a very long time. And we decided to join forces at some point in time, last autumn, when we noticed that there were issues in defining the next versions of GRC-XML that were related to the question of how can I use XBRL data in GRC beyond, and how can I use them in a very interoperable way. And this led us to examining how this semantic technology work we did in a previous research project for the European Commission could be combined with GRC-XML. So this is why we are talking about quite different things in one presentation. And I will just present you an agenda and then hand over to Saeed. So we will first of all explain the GRC-XML program that as it is backed up by user organizations, by XBRL vendors, we'll talk about its architecture. And as it is an XBRL standard, it will be interesting to look into the taxonomy model and information model that is underlying GRC-XML. And as we are talking about governance and risk and compliance, we will look a little bit deeper into the specific way that risks and control activities and their properties are represented in this standard. And this will exactly bring us to the question, how can we fully leverage the data richness and the metadata richness that XBRL provides in order to optimize this GRC processing and the representation of GRC data and metadata. So this will then lead to the second part of the talk about semantic technology interoperability. And actually what we did in this EU project was building an ontology for certain aspects of XBRL, quite a few of them. And I will then show you a little bit what are the relationships between GRC-XML and this metamodel work. We then will dwell a little bit more in detail on this semantic technology approach to understanding and representing and actually storing XBRL data. So I hope this will be quite interesting. We will also show you that a lot of it can be automatically generated, so it's not just abstract modeling work, but it's actually modeling work that can lead to very specific generation processes. Yeah, and we will conclude with some ideas on the next steps for GRC-XML 2.0. So, and now I might hand over to Saeed.
Yes, thanks, Marcus. Let's see if I can Okay, hi everybody. First, I want to thank Herm and for inviting us here, give us the opportunity to talk to you. Quick question to everybody. I'm sure you heard about GRC. If someone didn't, just tell us, raise your hand. You didn't hear about GRC. Okay, great. Two, three. Okay, great. So GRC stands for Governance, Risk, and Compliance. And it's a topic that's been hot for a number of years and extremely hot recently, obviously with the issues that we had with the financial crisis. We're looking for transparency and issues and how to drive the data from the lowest levels to the business kind of representation of it. So OCEG, which stands for Open Compliance and Ethics Group, is a nonprofit organization that took the lead in driving some of those efforts. In fact, became a provisional jurisdiction of XBRL and now in the process of moving to more a direct member. and started looking into these issues. And we said, you know, are we going to represent GRC information with yet again a new standard or leverage what exists? That's how we started looking at XBRL in the beginning. So just to, I should move probably to the next slide. Just a brief overview to obviously give you a little, if you think about GRC architecture across companies over the years, it's predominantly silo-based. So even within a single organization, you look, for example, at Siemens, which has 15 divisions and a number of sectors, three or four or more, that they are dealing with, you can imagine the complexity of that information and how risk information is presented differently from IT to the business, to operational, to HR, and so on. And it gets really hard for the board and the management to take action from there. And of course, quite easily you would think about why don't we have a common language to represent these pieces of information, whether it's risks, controls, policies, procedures, etc., and facilitate the interchange. So what we did, we said, you know, let's take GRC-XML and let's do this work by reusing what's available in the market, what's available within the various organizations. I have been involved with a number of standards organizations from OMG to W3C to OASIS, and some of them that are purely financial driven, like FPML and so on. But we haven't seen any area where this information has been represented or provided at least some efforts in standardization, although there is some metamodeling effort that I was actually personally involved with within OMG, and the work that was presented to you this morning on the abstract models is also work that's being done by leveraging yet some other standards. Anyway, so GRC-XML is actually XBRL. So when we show you some examples, or if you look at examples, you'll see XBRL behind the scene. And so leveraging XBRL, and it is highly integrated with XBRL's global ledger framework. So you might ask why. Well, one of the issues that we wanted to deal with is this ability to enable transparency from the lowest level of data. So you have the balance of an account to the highest level of that information if you're looking at the objectives or the goals of the company or a division, and then one level up if it's a subsidiary of something else. And this is the goal that we set up to try to achieve. Enable highly efficient and agile risk and control monitoring systems in a format that is application neutral and easy to integrate. That you can imagine, we wrote a white paper, by the way, that's available freely within the OCEG website, which you can read. It was written together with some of our members, a number of them who participated who are here, very active, such as Fujitsu and PwC and others. And try to address the business problem, you know, what's the business case actually, why are we doing this? So that will give you a little bit more detail. Here are some of the requirements. So if you look at a risk and control taxonomy, it's from a business process view, so in terms of the way we're approaching it, they function very similarly to charts of accounts. So we're looking at, let's look at these requirements. Standard risk and control models, there are a number of them, COSO, COBIT, you know, ITOL, for those of you who know some of those, PCI for credit cards, and et cetera, et cetera. There are a number of those, but, you know, they're all different. There's no common language. If you work with one of them, you have to standardize it. You have to take some of those controls. Some of them may not make sense to you in your environment, in your company, in your vertical, et cetera. So the next one was to define a standard XBRL taxonomy of controls and risks. So we said XBRL has been around for 10 years at the time or more, so why don't we leverage what has been done and try to actually work with some of our colleagues who have been involved directly into those efforts. And then in terms of integration, we're thinking of various systems. We talked about them. We know that a lot of them are silo-based. So if we want to deliver this integration, let's take a look at the level of the transaction data, the information level of detail, to deliver mappings that can be automated. And of course, leverage XBRL for external reporting. It's there, so let's use it, so you can actually do your reporting. In fact, in the US, mutual funds recently, last couple of years, I think now, if you go to Edgar, you can see their reporting, actually, on risks. They're still just text-based. So we hope that this can be taken to the next level, where it could be information that can be leveraged automatically by information systems. So use XBRL for evidence information. Evidence information is really important if you want to test your controls, right? So controls are there to help you mitigate your risks. And that's the kind of approach. I'll show you a model that will describe that. And therefore, you need that evidence information, right? So you can deliver this traceability and further enable transparency. So as Mark has said, we actually finished version 1.0. We were in beta, and we are releasing it over the next few days. At Compliance Week, we'll make an announcement. And that version is what I'm talking about here. And at the end, we'll be talking about the work we're doing currently to take us to the next level. Because interestingly, today probably one of the biggest buzzwords you hear about in information technology is cloud computing, right? Every company is becoming cloud-enabled. And so we've been asked actually to, how do we do GRC on the cloud? And that's what's going to take us to the next level. We'll talk about it later. So this model, for those of you, I'm sure this morning, it's very technical. So this is a UML model that just represents this information. If you think about it from centrally, if I can point to the control being the centerpiece here of information, of knowledge in some way, being something that can mitigate risk. And we can have various kinds of risks here represented, operational, IT, et cetera, and financial, of course. And internal controls are related to business processes, of course, and they have different kinds of properties themselves. And at the bottom there, the test of controls that are represented to do that. And in addition, activities, or what we call procedures. And of course, on the left side, the things that can actually impact those risks or have an influence on them. So this was the initial model that we created in order to support that version 1.0. And another area that we looked at is taking this into a prototype that was actually developed and actually described in detail in the white paper. And the prototype was using COSO, evaluation tool. This is actually a number of activities in COSO, about 25 of them here, that were represented in the tool that we created. So the whole idea there is to demonstrate the usability of GRC-XML. Just to show you some screenshots there. So this is the taxonomy definition link view. And by the way, the version 1.0 is also available for download. So you can actually download that and look at all of these things on your own. Being familiar with XBRL, you can use your tool of choice to do that. Right? It's just to illustrate some of that work. And in addition, one of the requirements that we had is to enable extensions, right? So you can actually take the GRC-XML model, take the existing taxonomies, but then you want to add some extensions of your own. And obviously, it's something that you can actually do in XBRL. So here you can see test of controls at the top, and then a number of attributes that were actually initially driven by a number of models, including some of the work that was done by NIST in the US. So you have like control categories, the types, requirements, etc. And finally, just maybe some instance to show you an example that we're looking here, being able to accurately, if I can read this, record invoices on a timely basis, etc., etc. So you can actually understand the based on those 25 activities. It may not be very readable. I apologize for those of you in the back. But the slides will be available, I assume, right?
Yes.
And again, I can point you to a URL. We can download the tool and the GRC-XML version 1.0. So just an example. Actually, this was based on this 800 series. And here's a listing of those. For those of you who are curious, look into the files. And this would look familiar to you from an XBRL standpoint. These were the GRC-XML added extensions. And then the custom extensions at the top, and an example of the at the instance level, just the structure of it. Okay. So I wanted to actually give you a little bit of another illustration. This is a real prototype that was working. So what we tried to do is to work with a tool that was provided at the time by Paisley, which is now Thomson Reuters. Their focus is on documentation. They document controls and risks, which are obviously for auditing purposes and internal. And then we had another company that provided us with an environment to do the monitoring of the tests of the controls themselves. And of course, additionally, some examples of systems that can actually take advantage of that. So this was an illustration of how that system was working, right? Between the repository, tools that can do continuous monitoring in the middle, and then other applications or services that can take advantage of that. Okay. I think we're doing good on time. So this is almost like a transition slide. I've used this slide in the past, actually, a number of times. The idea here is we look at this not as data, we're looking at it as knowledge assets, in the sense that if you are aware of your risk, you're aware of your controls, and you can, and again, across your silos, across your subdivisions, and within large corporations particularly, you can actually take advantage of that information. So what we did here is actually provide, and this is based also on working prototypes, where XBRL-GL documents or XBRL information, together with standards, XML-based standards for rule languages, can be used as input for decision engines, rules engines, policy, BPM, business process engines, to generate output. And at the bottom there at the corner is what we call the learning organization. So over time you're learning to be more efficient and be more effective in how you're dealing with your risk information, your influences internally, externally, and optimize your policies and procedures. I'm just giving you a little bit of that, and I think Marcus can take that and say a few more things about that, and then we can talk a little bit more about GRC-XML 2.0.
Okay, excellent. Thanks a lot, Said. Yep. Okay, so as you see on this slide, you see there is the notion of a knowledge asset, and actually you see here things like the semantics of business vocabularies and rules, the rule markup language mentioned. So the basic idea is to fully exploit and fully process GRC data and use it with the metadata. We need some kind of representation of these data that is amenable to processing in terms of semantic technology, or let me put it a little bit more generically, in terms of artificial intelligence procedures. So basically, if we come now back to the issue that we are working now with XBRL, so we see there are things where we would like XBRL data to become more interoperable, and one possibility to achieve this is to build a suitable meta model, to build a meta model which goes beyond the XML schema as discussed this morning also in the metamodeling session. On this slide, just a few textual items that motivate this. So, for instance, what we have are business policies and rules that are essential to understanding GRC. So, a certain company may implement certain rules according to certain policies. And if we want to test, for instance, a control that this company operates for its effectiveness, we might look at those rules and say, hey, which rules are actually causing that this control is ineffective, or which rules are causing that it is effective. Similarly, if we build a test for the design, we are interested in looking at which policies are actually guiding the rules. And this, again, is very important if you look into auditing, not only in cloud computing, but also in accounting. Financial risk management, where really it has to be provable that certain policies are implemented. And finally, a last point here, which is currently very often discussed, is software assurance or assurance in general. And here we think about establishing argumentations, and argumentations means we are able to reason and say this is why something should not happen. So we give plausible reasons for people to accept that something is only happening very, very rarely. And if you think this sounds very abstract, I would like to mention at this point that the object management group is currently very intensively going into a specification which is called argumentation meta model. It sounds almost like very, very abstract, but they are actually wanting to do this in order to do things like software assurance and, of course, with cloud computing in mind. Okay, so given these requirements for XBRL meta model, we decided to look into earlier work that has been provided in a FP6 project for the European Commission called Musing. And there we built a meta model for the generally accepted accounting principles in XBRL using formal ontologies. And just to contrast this a little bit with the work that is currently being done by the Abstract Model Task Force, I made this slide. So in this case, if we use ontologies, we are not in the same modeling language stack as we are in UML, because the very, very top level so-called meta-meta model is here description logic and not the meta-object facility. But let me mention immediately, there is a specification again by the object management group, which is called ontology definition meta model, excuse me for all this meta stuff, but it's called this way, which allows you to transform between ontologies and UML models. So what I'm saying here is that we are not just building ontologies and saying this is another world than UML, it is a world that can to some degree be combined and transformed into UML and also from UML. So the purpose in that earlier research project was the integration of XBRL data into domain models and BI, business intelligence services, for Basel II risk assessment. So that was an earlier project, and you will still find a lot of about it on the web pages, and given the time we have, I'm not going too deep into this. Now, just to give you a feeling of what this ontology approach is about, except all those abbreviations and meta models. Just let me show you this little slide. So we are all very used to XBRL terminology in terms of concepts and facts. So what is that in an ontology? A concept in XBRL in an ontology is nothing but a class. It's a class which consists of individuals or instances. And an XBRL fact is nothing, if you talk in ontology terms, than an instance of an ontology class. So if you, a class would be, for instance, the class of animals, then an instance of lions, then an instance would be a particular lion roaring at you. Okay, a little, the main problem in transforming or working with XBRL in ontologies is a good understanding of taxonomies. And I will come back to this a little bit later on, and I will show you that some naive approaches that people have tried are not working, especially in terms in view of calculation links, dimensions, and so on. So the important consequence of this is, and this links quite nicely to, I think, the very interesting talk we heard before. In this Oracle XBRL extension, you heard that the integrity of documents is preserved at all times. Yeah. So if you represent XBRL data by an ontology, you are actually not doing this anymore. Since each fact is an instance, the document integrity is maintained by queries only, because you have unique identifiers by a set of foreign keys where you can recover the document, but the instance the document as instance view is clearly dissolved if you represent it in an ontology. So I hope this slide gives you a little bit an idea of what this is about beyond all those abbreviations and meta model stuff. So now, if it comes to modeling, you unfortunately have to, at some point in time, to decide what you really use. And currently, in the area of semantic technology, there is a World Wide Web Consortium recommendation, which is called Web Ontology Language, abbreviated OWL, or OWL, and the Resource Description Framework that is, for instance, used by Thomson Reuters in their OpenCalais service. So, and if you use that, you have some very straightforward convenience transformations that go from XBRL to an ontology. So, for instance, you can use label links and transform them to so-called labels in the resource description framework, and this gives you a very easy way to represent the XBRL labeling. But you can do more in a quite straightforward way. So the arc role types, they usually correspond to object properties. I will show you examples on the next slides. Yeah, to object properties like domain and range. For instance, in Said's model, you would have the risk. You have an objective, and this objective incurs typically a risk. This would be an arc role in XBRL and an object property in an ontology. And so on. So linked role types correspond to named properties or association, and so on. So all this is quite promising. There is one thing which is, I would call it a caveat here, we wrote disadvantage. So there is a popular format for representing OWL in terms of concrete syntax, and this is called RDF-XML. And the disadvantage of that, which we may discuss in the reception afterwards, is that it is very hard to consume this by schema-aware processors. So once you move to the semantic web, you might have a problem getting out again. So that's very, very interesting, and you have to be careful about it. So interestingly enough, right now, alternatives to ODAP, and we have had discussions about that before, because you from XBRL would say, why should we move to this kind of syntax, and so on. Okay, so, but alternatives are getting popular. One very interesting is the so-called common logic that is also supported by the Rule ML group and the object management group. Okay, now time has come to present you a few examples. And again, I hope this is almost readable at least. So one example you see here is the XBRL item. And you see now, and this is a little bit in contrast to what we have seen at noon today, is that you do not have classes and classes, but you link all the contextual information via properties. So for instance, entity, period, scenario, and so on. And the nice thing about it here is that you can, the advantage of using the ontology is what we call intelligent information processing, is that you can use so-called upper ontologies. What is an upper ontology? That is a general framework for reasoning about some domain of interest. So for instance, what you can use here is an upper ontology for temporal relationships. And there are, this is just like taking a library in C++ or in Java. So you can use this ontology, and once you do this, your whole XBRL representation is enabled for temporal reasoning. You can do things like what happened during the overlap of periods, what happened when periods did not overlap, what happened in a succession of periods, and so on. And this is immediately there once you use this ontology basic construct. The rest of the slide, I think, is rather straightforward. Now, well, straightforward when from the, sorry, from the, oh my God, it's a pity you don't believe it, but really, if you could read it, I mean that's my, it basically says that an item has contextual information, so it's more or less in this sense straightforward. So okay. Now, but the contrast to it, which I wanted to make, is this one, because it took us quite some time to think of a good method of representing XBRL taxonomies in an ontology, because the first idea would be like going like you do in biology, take classes and subclasses and so on, but this is not good because you need calculation links, you need dimensions, so there are things that are not very well fitting with subclassing. And what we found out again that a good solution here is use of an upper ontology, and in this case an ontology that allows you to reason from parts to wholes and from wholes to parts. And if you think of a calculation link, given your presentation, for example, on formulas, what you're doing is actually calculating a formula means you are going from parts to wholes. So you are actually composing things. And what we do in this ontology is nothing but expressing this in a formal way. And once we have done this in a formal way, again, the advantage is that anything you can use as a reasoner on part-whole relationships is immediately available for an ontology and for the representation of the XBRL. And just to make sure that you don't believe this is all only possible with semantic technology and we don't have this and want to have this, here you find a UML model that captures exactly the same kind of relationships as in the previous slide, but this in this case with the class diagram in UML. And for those of you who are working with UML, you will recognize these little guys are called association classes. And they are doing exactly the same thing as we did in the ontology. They are associating an item with composing items. So they are a nice way of representing the composition of things towards a common thing, or concepts toward a common concept in UML. Okay, so this is also published, and you can find all the details in that earlier paper. I promised you to say something about automated ontology generation. So if, for instance, we built the ontology for the full GAAP set of XBRL items, which is, if I remember correctly, about 2,700. And of course, we did not sit down and type this in.
So what we used was actually XSLT, also mentioned already this afternoon, the transformation language for XSL or XML data. And we used so the concepts from XBRL, we used the link-based information, the arc roles, the role types, and so on, and defined rules for transforming this into an ontology. So the ontology I showed you before was completely automatically built. And actually with code which is not too long. It's not like 100 pages of XSLT, it's 3 to 4 pages. Finally, I would like to come to a last point, which is very often discussed here, is it's the point of dimensions. And I would like to talk about the common warehouse meta model, which is very nice, another way to see how to make XBRL data interoperable, which we looked at in this EU project. So we said, if XBRL has this concept of dimension, couldn't we express this in a more interoperable way? Not losing or using the power of XBRL, but making it available to something else. And I'm seeing I'm a little getting out of my time, so I will be a little bit short about this. So what we used here is the so-called UML profiling mechanism, which is another way of building meta models. It means you build a meta model that is entirely conforming or is embedded in the modeling hierarchy of UML, of the Unified Modeling Language. And we use this then to describe warehouse concepts in terms of XBRL. So as I said, the time is getting a little bit short, but what we found out is now that we could really show which constructs in XBRL are representing, which modeling elements in XBRL are representing which modeling elements in the common warehouse meta model. Working on this would enable, in the next step, would enable people to build XBRL for, let me say, a usual data warehouse application. Okay, so this is, I think, a little tour de force around what we did in terms of semantic technology. I hope it shows you it is a very, very broad approach. And now we come back to how we want to use this in GRC-XML. And this is where I'm going, giving back to Said.
Okay. Thanks, Marcus. Thank you. Okay. So as I said earlier, we are working towards version 2.0. And Marcus has talked a lot about the various standards that are around. And this is the awareness that we want to be able to reuse what's available. And also, I guess this thing is not working. Okay. Be able to demonstrate the value in key application areas. And I mentioned one of them is cloud computing. Two aspects are really important that we were asked about is GRC as it relates to both security and privacy issues, which is a huge topic. In order to bring that, companies, particularly financial services, to adopt this new information technology model, we would have to solve this problem. We're trying to work together, for instance, with Cloud Security Alliance, with NIST, with ISO, with a lot of European members as well, here in Europe. Second point, regarding the meta-modeling, there are several options, of course, exploring this cooperation with XBRL, which is the work that Marcus just presented to you. And of course, beyond that, there's further research that is needed for delivering this intelligent GRC, including inferencing and argumentation for assurance, etc. A lot of this work cannot be done manually. It has to be automated and therefore be able to provide the tooling and help the vendors to do that. And I think looking at rule-based automation, continuous control monitoring technologies and standards, and using XBRL and XBRL-GL, particularly XBRL-GL for evidence information and the proof. And finally, I just wanted to give you a little bit of a sneak preview of the model draft we're working on. We have about 15 companies that are participating in this effort in 2.0. Some of them that have contributed tremendously, such as PwC and Fujitsu, and a few others, Oracle and SAP and IBM, have provided input in the beginning, hope to get that back as well. But a number of user companies such as Dell and a few others that have been also participating, and some of financial services companies. What you see here versus the previous model, a lot more information provided. You can still see controls at the middle. You see the relationship with the risk information. We will detail a little bit more the types of risks that we're going to deal with. And the business process, as you can see at the top, we're detailing this notion of control objectives, the notion of control activities, even taking it to the level of regulations. So we want to go to the source. As new regulations come in, companies create policies, they can adopt these types of models so that they can trace back their controls or their data information back to the regulation. And the rest of the information is pretty much the same. The introducing rules, things that we probably can take advantage, particularly from the XBRL standpoint. And of course, this is work in progress. We want to thank you. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer those.
So you use a semantic analysis for XBRL and for risk. So when we develop taxonomies, okay, we have some problem because we have to define some concept, and we want to have the semantic analysis of this concept. Okay. And so there is a tendency to use dimension for that. Mm-hmm. And the problem is that dimension, we augment the number of dimensions of taxonomies, which become more and more complex. Yeah. But the idea is, what would we use this kind of technology to determine the semantics? So do you have some work in progress, for example, from comparability, for example, between taxonomies, the same thing?
Yeah.
Do you have some work in progress or some...
You want to answer? I can actually... there's work that has been done in the past for comparing concepts in general, not concepts as in XBRL, but beyond that, in terms of using, as Marcus said, description logic, ontologies, and rules. And in the work we're doing, we need to do that. As you said exactly, for example, in GRC-XML, when you're passing information, risk information or control information back and forth, you want to compare it. I'll give you an example that's very specific. Right now, coming back to the cloud, because I'm very specific, it's more recent, we have a lot of vendors that are going to provide services and for hosting and so on. So you want to be able to compare between them. So those are kind of examples that are very concrete. You want to add something?
Yeah. Yes, so I would like to add two things. The first thing is there is a lot of testing of semantic technology capabilities around. So, for instance, companies like Allegro Graph are really testing semantic technology on huge amounts of data. What we did in using is comparatively was smaller, but it was to the same, it went into the same direction. But I think here the main issue of this collaboration is not to change the syntax of XBRL. The issue would be to say, how can we make the XBRL data interoperable in the most simple manner? So can we have a transformation that will allow us not to use all of these ontologies, but to use a subset of it such that we can express rules in a way that we can transform them back into calling XBRL formulas? And So you see, it's a way of interoperability rather than suggesting a complete change in the data representation. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Any other questions? Okay, like I said, the tools are version 1.0 is available. You can download it. There is some evaluation tool. We use the Fujitsu tool, but you can obviously use your tool of choice. And we really appreciate feedback. And Aaron, thank you again for inviting us.
Yeah. Thank you.